visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea, and the four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion, and had an eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man, and as a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast, a second like unto a bear, it was raised up itself on one side, and it had three nibs on the mouth of it, between the teeth of it, and said thus unto it, Arise, devour much flesh. After this I beheld, and lo, another like unto a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. After this I saw the night visions, and behold, the fourth beast, a dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had ten horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up from among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and the mouth speaking great things. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like of pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands, thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, the books were opened. I beheld then, because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake, I beheld even till the beast was slain, and his body destroyed, and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beast, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, and that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed.
Thank you. I just want to say from the beginning, we're going to go over a lot of information today, okay? So bless you. I don't want you to get scared, okay? So I'm going to try to slow down as slow as I can. But we have a lot of information that is given in Daniel chapter 7. And once you understand the information and how it comes together, then when we get to the interpretation of Daniel chapter 7 and we get into Daniel 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, then it'll make much more clear, be clear to you, make much more sense to you. So I don't want to scare anybody that's come for the first time and say, oh my, what is that? It's just a little different today because it's going to be quite a bit of information given. All right, so Daniel chapter 7 is the last chapter in the which the Aramaic language, okay, which the Aramaic language is used in the book. You say, what do you mean? Well, I gave you this handout, and if you need one, you can get one when you leave today. There's a handout that we gave out at the very beginning. Chronologically, as you go through the book of Daniel, it's chapters 1 through 4, then you go to 7, 8, and then you go back to 5, 6, and then you go 9, 10, 11, and 12, okay? So where are we at today? Today, we're in chapter 7. We've already went through chapter 5 and chapter 6, but chronologically, this happens right after chapter 4, okay? So I don't want to confuse you or anything, but just chronologically going through, that's how the book is laid out, all right? And so what I want you to see today is from Daniel chapter 2, verse 4, all the way to Daniel chapter 7, verse 28, which is the end of this chapter, the book is written in Aramaic, likely because the focus is on the Gentile nations. Daniel 1, 1 through 2, 3, and Daniel 8 through 12 are written in the Hebrew language. All right, so the Old Testament is written in the Hebrew language with some Aramaic, and this is the Aramaic we're going through right now, of the Aramaic language. The New Testament is written in Greek. Okay, thank you. God bless you. That's great. Greek, all right? So Greek in the New Testament, in the Old Testament, you have Hebrews, Hebrew language, and then the Aramaic is what we're looking at right now. All right? Daniel 7 begins the second major division of this entire book. You remember the first division of the book looked at practical things, and it looked at Daniel and his personal friends. But this second division, from 7 on through 12, is prophetical and concerns Daniel and his people's future. All right, the visions cover the prophecies beginning with the time of the Gentiles. That's when they came and they took over Jerusalem, the time of the Gentiles, and that will occur all the way till the end, until you get to the thousand-year millennial reign when Jesus Christ takes over. Okay? So we're doing some things here, and it's close of the age. The close of this age comes with the great tribulation period of what we're talking about, the times of the Gentiles. The two coming dictators who first loom before us is described here as the little horn. I don't know if you got that when he was reading, but the little horn, although the little horn here in chapter 7 is not the same little horn that'll be in chapter 8, okay? So I want you to understand that. This little horn that we're going to talk about today in chapter 7, and probably the next time we meet in chapter 7, will be the little horn called the Antichrist. The little horn that's found in chapter 8 of Daniel is Antiochus. Can be confusing because it's Antichrist, chapter 7, Antiochus in chapter 8. Okay, so I just want to point some things out to you so when you read this, you don't get confused. You know where you're at contextually, and you know which is what. Well, Daniel had known for some time, as you remember, we saw that Daniel, when he had Belshazzar, he went to Belshazzar's feast. Belshazzar said, hey, I'm going to give you all of these things. Daniel said, I don't need any of those things. He already knew that. He already knew what was going on. Belshazzar had no idea. But Daniel already knew. And so he was fully aware of what was going on. So what I want you to see today is Daniel's first vision. Daniel's first vision. You remember, Daniel interpreted dreams from Nebuchadnezzar and others, but this is the first time that you hear his vision of what God gave him. And so he's dreaming, and he's writing his dream down. and writing that down so you and I could see it, and you're going to see that it matches up exactly with what Nebuchadnezzar and what he interpreted Nebuchadnezzar's dream found in Daniel chapter 2. Okay? So you'll see this and it'll be very clear. Number one, the introduction to the dream. The introduction to the dream. There's two things here. The introduction, first of all, when Daniel dreamed. When Daniel dreamed and what Daniel dreamed. So first of all, when Daniel dreamed. Verse 1 says, in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon. Okay, so you remember when we were in chapter 5, Belshazzar the king made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords. And we said, well, who in the world is Belshazzar? Because he just shows up. Well, Belshazzar here in chapter 7, this is the first year of Belshazzar's reign. Belshazzar reigned with his father. Remember who that was? Nabonidus was his daddy. Nabonidus was the ruler at Babylon at that time. And what did he do? Nabonidus served 17 years, and for the last 10 years, he took a hiatus and he went south and to a place called Tema with his wives, and he spent time there. Where Belshazzar took over for the last 10 years. And Belshazzar, just like anybody that's been handed the keys to anything else, he didn't know what he was doing. And he thought he was safe. He thought everything was good. Let's party, have a good time. Nobody can take Babylon. We're at the height. We're the greatest in the world. And he fell asleep literally at the wheel. What happened is he got his kingdom taken away. Daniel told him that it was going to happen, and it did happen. But this is prior to that. Okay, so chronologically, what's going on? This is prior to that. This is prior to that happening. So Belshazzar is the king now at this time. The second thing I want to see is what Daniel dreamed. What Daniel dreamed. Daniel spake and said, verse 2, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea. Okay, so you say, okay, well, what in the world is this? The vision of this chapter must have awakened memories of Daniel's youth. When he was first brought before who? Before King Nebuchadnezzar to interpret the king's dream of the great image found in Daniel chapter 2. The vision of the four great beasts and the dream of the great image had much in common. They were very similar. Both visions were concerned with the course of Gentile power. Gentile world power down throughout the ages. The chief difference was the perspective of these dreams. The heathen monarch envisioned such power as something glorious, something to be put on a pedestal and worshiped. And you remember, that's what Nebuchadnezzar did. He made a gold image of himself, and he had everybody bow down for that. You remember that? Well, the saintly Hebrew prophet saw Gentile world power as something like a beast. He saw it as a dreadful to behold. Nebuchadnezzar saw the Gentile world power as a vast human image. Will be proportioned, intelligent, godlike, and splendid. And the substance, the strengths, and the scenarios were varied, but the symbol was one complete whole. And Daniel saw the differences between the empires and saw their true characters as God saw them. You remember Nebuchadnezzar was the first world ruler, emperor, mostly saw things that concerned the beginning and ending of Gentile world power. The head of the gold, the feet and toes of the image, the smiting stone from heaven. The saintly prophet saw all four empires, but was mostly impressed with the final features of Gentile world power when the Antichrist comes on the scene. He also saw the essential differences between the empires because the beasts were diverse one from the other. And moreover, although the empires succeeded one another in the inevitable march of history, Daniel saw them at once the way God sees the passing events of time. So first of all, as we're going through here, the striving wins. What is that? The striving wins. The four winds of heaven as they strove upon the great sea. The geographical location is significant. In the case of Nebuchadnezzar's vision, it was Babylon that was important. The world empires of Scripture became world empires as they seized and held Babylon. In the providence of God, world rule originally intended for the Jews was now vested instead in Nebuchadnezzar, the first Babylonian empire and the first king to conquer Jerusalem and hold it in bondage to Gentile power. Thus began the times of the Gentiles. Luke chapter 21, verse 24, okay, says this, "And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled." This is in the New Testament of Luke chapter 21. Okay, this time is now. Where we're going through right now and what we're looking at is the age, the time of the Gentiles. They are in ruling power over Jerusalem and over Israel. I know I've said a lot already. You have to understand this. Number one, the Jewish people and Israel are very important. The Bible makes a big deal about this. Don't look at me and say, well, you just make a big deal about that. No, go to the text and see. If you're reading your Bible at all, you understand there's one place that's very important. That place is called Jerusalem. It is the apple of God's eye. So I make no bones about that. You have to understand that. If you don't understand that going into it, then you're just going to say, well, this makes no sense at all. It makes no sense because your eyes aren't the same as God's eyes. And God has given this to Daniel so Daniel could give it to you and me, and we could see that. And he's given it over and over and over and over again, as you see through the Word of God. So he gave it, first of all, to Nebuchadnezzar, a man who had a dream, and Daniel interpreted the dream and said, this is what the dream is. And then he gives the visions, the dreams, to Daniel. So Daniel now is experiencing what's going on. And this is world history that we're talking about. This is a lot of time in the window of time. So this is where we're at when you come to the book of Daniel. God's original purposes will be fulfilled. Until then, all of the world empires of Scripture held Babylon. All were Babylonian in character, and every one of them trod down the city of Jerusalem. So that's the striving winds. Secondly, the stormy waves. The stormy waves. Daniel dreamed this in verse 2. The significant geographical location in Daniel's vision was the Great Sea, which in the Bible refers to the Mediterranean Sea. The Mediterranean Sea. I'm going to give you a picture here in a minute. You'll be able to see this, okay? This is the Roman Empire. This is the Mediterranean Sea. This is where Jerusalem is here, okay? This Mediterranean Sea became very important because all of the empires that we're going to look at, they all butted up against the Mediterranean Sea until you get to the last one, which is the Roman Empire, and the Mediterranean Sea actually became the Mediterranean Lake in the middle of this great empire. So you say you're with me now? Very important that you understand that. The Mediterranean Sea is the Great Sea that is talked about there. Okay? So as we go through this contextually, so you'll understand where we're at. As Gentile world power became to move steadily westward, that's to your left as you look at the map, okay? Because I know many people are geographically challenged. Whenever you look at a map, north is up, south is down. Whenever you look at a map, right is east and left is west. Okay? So whenever it's, hopefully it'll help many. Whatever map you look at, it's always laid out the same. North, south, east, west. All right? I better turn around so you know that. North, south, east, west. All right? So you got that. And so I know, and we laugh about it, but it's okay. If you're geographically challenged, it's fine. I want you to understand the information. Because why? It's important to your life. It's important to your life. As Christian people, when someone comes to you and says, what in the world's going on in the world? Well, let me tell you what Daniel tells us. He said there'll be four empires. He said, and you know what? Every one of them's come true. And the last one will come true as well. And there'll be a revived Roman Empire that will come. And he'll be headed up by the Antichrist. And the Antichrist will rule the world. So you ought to have an answer to the questions people are asking. And you don't have to be, you don't have to be smart about it at all or anything. Just say, hey, friend, I love you. I just want to let you know that's what God's word says. And it's right here. I mean, you can read it. You can take your phone and you can pull up a Bible and you can look at it yourself. God wants everyone to know. God never comes without telling you he's coming. He's a total gentleman. He never shows up unexpectedly. You're just like, well, I didn't. Yeah, you did. He says, I'm coming back. He said that for thousands of years now. So there's nobody in the universe who could say, I had no idea. He's been telling you. He's been telling you. The question is, are you ready? And you need to be ready. And we as Christian people ought to be ready to give an answer of what we believe and why we believe it. And when people find that you are a source of that information, then not only can you tell them something about what's going on in the world, you can actually tell them something about the Lord Jesus Christ and what he means in your life, and it turns the light on for them. And the Spirit of God will use you in the lives of people. He wants to do that. And I want to be encouragement to you to understand, when we go through the book of Revelation, we went through the book, when we're going through the book of Daniel, if you'll take that information and you will use it in the workplace, in the neighborhood, at the grocery store, wherever you're at, to answer people that have questions. Because a lot of times they don't get the answer from anywhere else. And you can be an answer to them. And God wants to use you to do that. He desperately wants you to be able to do that. And we can. So the striving winds, we see the stormy waves, all right? The great sea, little more indeed than the Roman lake. Babylon from the Mediterranean Sea was 500 to 600 miles from the sea, but its conquest brought it to its eastern and southern shores. Persia was even farther away, but it too came to the great sea and hurled its armies and its navies against Greece. And we'll see what I'm talking about here in a minute when we see this. You have Babylonian Empire, you have the Medo-Persian Empire, you have the Greek Empire, and you have the Roman Empire. Okay? Those are four things that you can just easily memorize. Okay? So the first one's Babylonian, the second one comes is the Medo-Persian, and then the third one is the Greek Empire, and then the fourth one's the Roman Empire. All right? You ought to just know those just immediately. Four of them. Boom, 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 boom. And that's history. That's history. That's not made up fairy tale stuff. That's actual history. I know some of you don't like history at all. Well, I just gave you four things, key things that you can hang on to that are very important in history. So you know some history now. All right? And so we see this. One significance of all of this lies in the fact, by the time Rome came to power, Palestine was the geographic center of the prophetic earth. Of the earth, of where is the center of the universe? The center of the universe is found in a place called Jerusalem. It's the apple of God's eye. And it's the center of everything that we talk about prophetically. What is going on? Why do you think when you get on your internet tomorrow or you look at the news, why is everybody talking about Jerusalem and about Israel? I mean, it's not the biggest place in the world by any stretch of the imagination. But it gets the front of the news. Why? Because it's important. It's important. So understand that as we go forward, that this is the center. So the expression the Great Sea fixes for us the predominant sphere of interest in this vision of Daniel. In fact, the four winds of the heaven symbolizes four great angel princes, those principalities of Satan who rule over the four nations that were to seize world power. And there are the powers of the air, the forces of evil, one against which we strive today in prayer. We see this in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's who we're up against. And so who are these people and what's going on with them? They are subject to Satan. And through him, he holds the nations of the earth in chains. Daniel saw them strive for mastery of the prophetic earth. Each in turn was able to parade his own particular wild beastly kingdom in front of and as prize exhibit for the prophet saw four great beasts come up from the sea, diverse one from another as a result of the striving of the four winds. The nations represented by the four wild beasts correspond to the nations symbolized by the same exact four metals of the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw in his dream. Now, do you remember this? If you were here for the book of Daniel, remember this. This is the dream that that Daniel interpreted that King Nebuchadnezzar had. At the top is the head, the Babylonian the Great. It's the lion we're going to talk about next week. It's King Nebuchadnezzar, okay? And then there's the Silver Age. It's the age of the Medes and the Persians. Then you have the Grecian Macedonian, the leopard. That's the Hellenistic period. Then you have the iron, the Roman Empire, the iron. It gives the legs as well as the feet and the toes. This is Daniel chapter 2, and this is also Daniel chapter 7. The lion, the bear, the leopard, and the beast. Okay, if you've never seen that, that should be very clear to you as you read Daniel chapter 2 and as you read Daniel chapter 7. So that you put those two together and you say, okay, this makes sense. This isn't crazy. This really makes sense. And he's given the history of the world to Daniel in saying that, hey, this is what's going to come about. Many of you are excited about we get to the 69 weeks and the 70 weeks in Daniel chapter 9. You got to understand this stuff before you get to Daniel chapter 9. That's why Daniel chapter 1 through 8 is before Daniel chapter 9. Okay, so you got, if you understand this stuff, then when you get there, you're like, well, that makes sense. That's not crazy. That actually makes sense. For many people, they want to know all of these things, these intricate details. Let me tell you, you can know every intricate detail about every prophetical passage that's out there. And if you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, you will die and you'll split hell wide open. And friend, I love you to tell you that. If I didn't love you, I would not say anything, and I'd say, boy, this is really interesting stuff, and put this in your coat because this is important, and this will really, what, puff you up because you know the answer. Let me tell you, friend, the answer is this. We just celebrated 7 days ago the greatest historical event of all time. Of all time. It is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And friend, Jesus Christ loves you more than you love you. He created you, and he wants you to know that you are loved by him and you are thought of by him. And so I just want you to know that, friend. As we go through this information, it's information that's very important, and it'll come out, and you can apply this to your life. But don't forget, God is coming back. He will rule this world, and he is the king of all kings. And if you want to be in his kingdom, the only way into his kingdom is by bowing the knee and receiving the gift that he gives, and that's his son, Jesus Christ. That's so important to understand. So as we go through these details, please understand, God wants you to know that you can be in his kingdom today, right now. But he never forces anyone to do it. For whosoever will, let him come. And he opens his arms and he says, welcome to the kingdom of God. And so I just want you to understand that as we go through here, that don't get bogged down in the details and forget who is the authority. God is always the authority, and he never, ever lies to us. Okay? So we've seen the introduction here. I want you to look at the information in the vision. The information in the vision. And in this dream of the world empires, there are three things you need to know. There's three similar empires. There's also a subsequent empire. And then there is lastly, a supernatural empire. He gives that information out right here, okay? So first of all, the similar empires. The similar empires. In verses 4 through 6, the first one that we see, the first of the similar empires, was the one that was still in power when Daniel dreamed the dream, when he had the vision. And what was that? The first one was the supremacy of the Babylonian Empire. Okay, the supremacy of the Babylonian Empire. Verse 4 says this, "The first was a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld till the kings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it." Okay, what are we talking about? The first beast, like the ones that followed, came upon from the stormy sea, a symbol of the warring nations of humankind. Each of the four empires rode to power on the crest of a tidal wave of war. There was one war after another war. The Babylonian Empire had been set before Nebuchadnezzar under the symbol of gold, the richest metal. Daniel saw it as a lion, the king of beasts, and both symbols spoke of sovereignty and supremacy. The prophet Jeremiah had already used both symbols to depict Nebuchadnezzar, so Daniel was very familiar with them. Why? Because he was reading the prophet Jeremiah. Nebuchadnezzar's long reign began with a career of rapid conquest. You see this in verse 4 there. "I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth. First was a lion and had eagle's wings." A lion is very quick, and eagle's wings means, man, it's even quicker than you think. Okay? So look at what's being pictured there. It is the lion, and it has wings. It's very fast and will come upon you. And when you see this, because his conquests were really this way. He fell heir to the city, the roots of which reached into antiquity. We've went over this before. The original founder of Babylon was a man by the name of Nimrod. Genesis chapter 10, okay? So you can put over to the side and say, man, Genesis 10, I ought to look that up sometime. Genesis chapter 10, the man named Nimrod. He was one of the Old Testament types, one of the Old Testament types of the Antichrist, who we're going to talk about. He was a type of the Antichrist who also founded the Assyrian monarchy in Genesis chapter 10. Babylon was located at the point where the Euphrates River ceased to be a vast expanse and it became a passable river. By Daniel's day, the city already had a long history. It was the foundation, the fountainhead of idolatry. It was the home of astrology and astronomy, and it was the vanity fair of the ancient world. It was the place to be. And Nebuchadnezzar's swift conquests are depicted under the symbol of a lion with eagle's wings. The Battle of Carchemish. You see this? This is Assyria here. This is Babylon here. Carchemish. The Battle of Carchemish happened. What was going on? Egypt met here at Carchemish, the Babylonian Empire, and they lost. So he overtook Egypt as well. And you see this as you go through the next one here. This is this color green here goes all the way over here to Jerusalem, and he would take Egypt as well. And so all of this is taken by Babylon, by Nebuchadnezzar himself. So you see, it's a lion that has eagle's wings, and it goes quickly. The Battle of Carchemish, which humbled Egypt before Nebuchadnezzar, opened the way to the west, to the left. In a series of swift campaigns, he conquered all of Syria and Palestine, invaded Egypt, and he took ancient Tyre. But that career of conquest came to an end. Why did that conquest come to an end? Do you remember what happened to Nebuchadnezzar? What is it? He went mad, didn't he? What happened to him after that? He was restored. What happened to him in the middle of that? As an animal, he lived as an animal on the ground. And after that, God restored him, and I believe with all of my heart that he got converted. And he did what was right. So the last half, after he got converted, the last part of his dominion, of his emperor, while he was an emperor, it was much different than the first. Nebuchadnezzar then turned to domestic affairs. Look at chapter verse 4. It says, I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. Nebuchadnezzar turned to domestic affairs. He sent armies westward to punish restless provinces, as he did in Judea in 598 and 586, but war had lost its charms, and the lion was made to stand on its hind legs. The savage rage of the wild beast was replaced by the heart of a mortal man. And as Daniel well knew and recorded in Daniel 4, all of these events had come to pass as far as Nebuchadnezzar personally was concerned. The reigning emperor at the time, you remember, is Nabonidus. He was more interested in peaceful pursuits than in the art of war. And even Belshazzar would sit in the city of Babylon when the Medes and the Persians, howling at his gates, secure in the fond illusion that the need not trouble himself at all. Let it go. Let's party. Babylon was impregnable. The vision changed. Now Daniel was depicted. Secondly, the savagery of the Persian Empire. The Persian Empire. It's actually the Medo-Persian Empire, but Persia takes over. Okay? The second empire had none of the speed of the first one. It was a bear. A bear is much different than a lion. Okay? And it's relatively slow in contrast to a lion. It's ponderous in its movements. It just comes, wallers in, and just takes over. And that's the way the Medes and Persians did things. They just came in vast droves of people and savagely just took over. And that's what they were known for. And so you see this, it achieves its objectives. Persia, the Medo-Persian Empire, achieved its objectives by sheer strength and brute force. Seeking to crush its victims in its brace, it was powerful. The three ribs in the bear's mouth describe accurately the initial conquest of the Medo-Persian alliance. The three kingdoms that the Medo-Persian Empire swallowed were Lydia, Babylon, as well as Egypt. I think if you go here, you'll see that. So Lydia, Babylon, and Egypt. It swallowed all three of those up. Okay, and that's the Medo-Persian Empire. The empire was to devour much flesh. It was a characteristic of the method of waging war that it was involved in. It never moved unless it overwhelmed people, which would crush all the resistance there is. It would have plenty of people to take over. And it was wasteful when it came to human life. It was persistent in seeking its prey. When Darius marched through Scythia, for instance, he mobilized nearly 750,000 men, not counting his fleet of 600 ships. And when Xerxes marched against Greece, he took 2.5 million troops with him. This is a huge amount of people. And the movement of this mass of men looked more like a migration than it did an army. It was huge. It was very terrifying. When you got 1 million people coming against you, it is very terrifying. And so Persia's last and most peaceful king brought more than 500,000 men to the battle, and 2 years after their defeat was able to find another 1 million men for his final battle. They were about getting a lot of people together. All right, the policy of the Persian emperors was to fill the ranks of their armies with hordes of people from conquered lands, territories, stretching all the way from India to Mediterranean. Once again, the scene changed. What happened? Well, now you see the swiftness of the Grecian Empire. That's the third one. The Grecian Empire. The swiftness. What's the picture? A leopard?
A leopard is very, very fast. Very fast. And with its grace and beauty, speed and ferocity was a fitting symbol of Alexander the Great and the Greek Empire. The four wings of the leopard added to the picture, depicting the amazing speed with which the youthful Macedonian subdued the entire world. And you know this from history. Alexander the Great took over the world really quick, and he was really young. And he was absolutely at the height of where he could be when he died. And so the four heads of the leopard symbolize the division of Alexander's empire by his four generals. Who are they? I just list them up here for you. I think it's in the next one here. This is the division. Cassander, who took Macedon and Greece. Lysimachus, who took Asia Minor and Thrace. Seleucus, who took Syria, Upper Asia, Babylon in the east. And, you know how to pronounce that? It depends upon where you're from. If you're from the United States, you say Ptolemy. If you're not from the United States, you say Ptolemy. Okay, so you're right either way. So however you want to pronounce it. But Ptolemy, who seized Egypt, Palestine, and Arabia. Eventually, Palestine became a political football, kicked about by their heirs of Seleucus and Ptolemy. And these two divisions of the Greek Empire, they become the subject of further prophecy found where? In Daniel chapter 8 and Daniel chapter 11. We'll see them again. So now you know the backstory to it. Who are these people and where they come from? This is the backstory of where they're from. We'll get to that in Daniel 8. We'll also get to it in Daniel chapter 11. Now, the subsequent empire. You have the similar empires. Now the subsequent empire. The vision now turned to the next empire, one quite different from the others and marked off in the text by an introductory clause. See, Daniel was impressed first of all, the horror of the Roman Empire. Look at verse 7. The horror of the Roman Empire. After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Although this empire is never named, we have no difficulty in identifying it as the Roman Empire, the strongest and most enduring of all the prophetic empires. You see, in Nebuchadnezzar's, that's the Babylonian Empire, in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, this empire had been symbolized by legs of iron. As you go to this next slide here, this is legs of iron. Notice that these legs are long. They're very long. You say, well, why is that? Well, there's a reason that they're long. The long legs revealed that the Roman Empire would far outlast the other ones. You see, let me give you this. The Babylonian Empire lasted barely 70 years. The Persian Empire, it was about 200 years. The Greek Empire lasted about 180 years. However, the Roman Empire lasted over 500 years. That's more than all of them combined. The same idea of iron strength is evident in Daniel's vision. The great monster that he saw had iron teeth. Its power to rend and tear was great. And foremost among its many crimes must be counted what? The crucifixion of the Son of God. We just celebrated the Resurrection Sunday. This is right here. That was one of the most notorious crimes they ever committed. Nor was this crime of crimes enough. 10 Caesars, from Nero to Diocletian, persecuted the church ruthlessly. And this is documented in history. At that time in history, when this wild beast was raging against the church, the Apostle John was given further details. It's found in Revelation chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. John says, and I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear,
and his mouth is the mouth of a lion. You have Greek, you have the Medo-Persian, you also have the Babylonian Empire. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Who's the dragon? The Antichrist, Satan himself. Okay? So look at this and see. This is right here for you. We went over this. And I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wondered after the beast. He will be, watch this, resurrected. Sound familiar? You have to understand, Satan has no new plans. He wants to be like God, so he's got to what? He's got to act like him. So he puts together his own resurrection. And we went over this when we were in Revelation chapter 13, and we looked at the book of Revelation. So understand, this is what's going on in history. Daniel told us that this would go on. And so he makes it very clear. And so we're going through this. John saw it in its resurrected form. The Roman Empire in its resurrected form, the same but different. He saw that in its final form, the Roman beast would absorb the chief feature of all the previous prophetic empires. And like Daniel, John saw the 10 horns. He also saw 7 heads. Particularly, those empires those 7 heads are expressed as 7 mountains. In other words, the beast was identified with the city of Rome, which was built on 7 hills. And this is well known. In a still later vision in Revelation 17 we looked at, further details were added under the symbolism of a scarlet woman. And these new details were appropriate once the church age had begun, because the church was not subject of the Old Testament revelation. These later features were concealed from Daniel, and they were given later in the book of Revelation. Daniel saw first this beast in all of its horror, the part of the vision that was now passed into history. He also saw, number 2, the horns of the Roman Empire. The horns of the Roman Empire. Look at verse 7 again. And it had 10 horns. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things. Those 10 horns represented the 10 toes of Nebuchadnezzar's image. They likewise identify the beast in Daniel's vision with a beast in John's vision. In both cases, the symbolism points to the same thing, the end time reappearance of the Roman Empire in a new form. In Scripture, horns symbolize power. And what gripped and what mystified Daniel was something new and uncanny, the emergence of a malignant little horn among the others. And this little horn uprooted 3 of its competitors, but stranger still, and Daniel drew special attention because he says, behold. He says, and I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn. He gazed at it, fascinated, horror, mystified by it, but he had no time to ponder its significance. The vision continued. And finally, we see the supernatural empire. The supernatural empire. Up till now, the prophet's interest had been taken up with the rise and fall of these empires. And now, he was to see all human power, might, and dominion fade into insignificance. You see, his gaze was directed toward heaven. What did he see? Look at verse 9. First of all, he saw the throne. The throne. The rendering, I beheld till the thrones were cast down, can be translated, I beheld till thrones were set. The scene corresponds to the one found in Revelation chapter 4 and Revelation chapter 5, where we have no less than 17 references to the throne in 2 short chapters, Revelation 4 and 5. Along with these recurring references to the throne of God, the 24 elders and the seats, literally thrones, on which they sat are mentioned.
The 24 elders were celestial beings of mighty and majesty who form a kind of heavenly hierarchy, a jury of angelic beings whose function is to observe God's acts in judgment and render him obeisance for his wise and his wondrous ways. Daniel saw these thrones being set in preparation for the judgment of the fourth beast and the little horn. And central to the thrones of the angelic elders was another throne on which sat the Ancient of Days. He's the everlasting one. He's God Almighty. His dazzling white garment proclaimed his unsullied holiness. His hair, his pure wool, advertised his eternal being, his countless years, his experience, his majesty. It just explodes your mind when you try to put in words the greatness of the God that we serve. He is a great God. He's beyond anything you can imagine. He's much bigger than anything you can imagine. He's much greater than anything you can imagine. He's much purer than anything you can imagine. You can't put it in words, but you can experience it by receiving his gift. And when he comes into your life, it's a total change. It's a total change. And for the very first time, you can actually believe what's written about him. Before you receive the Spirit of God living inside of you, you read it and you just say, there's no way. After you receive him, you read it and you say, that's not enough. He's greater than that. Because he really is. He really is. And as we go detail after detail after detail, he knows all of those details. And he's orchestrated everything and put in place everything for it to occur. And he said, for whosoever will, let him come. Anybody that wants to come, let him come. I'm telling you, this is what's going to go on in the world. You don't have to experience that. Come. Just come. And he continues to say it over and over and over again. And he makes sure that you know what's coming. It talks about his throne being bathed in fire. It reminds you of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29. Our God is a consuming fire. Adding further details, Paul says later that when the time comes for the destruction of the Antichrist and his empire, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 and 8 says, the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God. Daniel's attention was next directed not only to the throne, but to the throng. To the throng. I mean, think about the multitudes of people that are there. A countless host hung on his words and rushed to his bidding. An even greater multitude stood before him in adoring wonder. Heaven above is interested in the affairs of earth below, and God chose this small planet of ours before its foundation to be the spot in the universe where the age-old mystery of iniquity would be localized. And here the sin question would be settled once for all to God's eternal satisfaction. God's judgment is not arbitrary. Friend, he keeps record, not because he needs them, but that those who are about to be condemned might face the record of their own actions and words. No incident, however small or seemingly insignificant, of all of the king's history of man's tenure of this planet has escaped the all-seeing eye of God. It is all written down. He looks and he sees the throne. He also sees the throng. When you look at this in verse 10, the throng of thousands upon thousands, 10,000s upon 10,000s, and then he sees the thrill. The thrill. First, Daniel had the thrill of seeing the vanquished one in verses 11 and 12. I love this. Verse 11 and 12. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which the horn spake, I beheld even till the beast was slain, and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame.
You remember that happened in Revelation. I think it's Revelation chapter 19, verse 20. And the false prophet, the Antichrist himself, the devil himself, they all three were thrown into the lake of fire. For how long? Forever. Forever. And so he's talking as concerning the rest of the beast. They had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. A season and time. The Antichrist empire will be destroyed, and the disintegration will begin when the eastern part breaks away and mobilizes against him. And we saw this in the book of Revelation. Its final demise will take place at the Battle of Armageddon. When Christ will come, the stone of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and put an end to the entire evil empire. And the doom of the former beast is mentioned in passing. One by one, the empires were swallowed up. The Medo-Persian empire swallowed up by the Babylonian empire, which fell intact. Alexander's empire was swallowed by the Persian empire. The Roman empire swallowed the Greek empire. So in a sense, the former empires had their lives prolonged for a season and a time. The revived Roman Empire will incorporate the features of all of the other earlier empires. And perhaps that is what is meant by the former empires having their lives prolonged for a time. But Daniel's greatest thrill was seeing the victorious one. He saw the presentation in verse 13. When the Lord Jesus was put under oath by the high priest. In verse 13 you see this. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. One like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven. Jesus Christ is always in the clouds of heaven. When he left in the book of Acts, what did he go up in? Clouds of heaven. You identify him there and came to the, who's the Ancient of Days? God the Father. He's the Ancient of Days. Oh, by the way, he's beyond days. There is no time. He's the Ancient of Days. And they brought him near before him. The next slide, Mark. Thanks. You find this in Matthew chapter 26. It's very interesting because it'll pull this together. Matthew chapter 26, but Jesus held his peace, and the high priest answered and said unto him, I adjure thee by the living God that thou tell us whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said unto him, thou hast said, nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. And then the next slide you see is found in Daniel 7:14. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. You see, the high priest asked, and the Lord referred him back to Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. And he says the same thing. Jesus claimed that he himself was the person referred to in those verses found in Daniel, that every one of those leaders that were there knew exactly what he was saying. The Jewish high priest and the Sanhedrin understood. No one doubted that the mysterious being seen in Daniel's vision was divine. And the unbelieving Jewish high priest declared immediately that Jesus had spoken blasphemy. In fact, he had only told the truth. He was and he is and he ever will be God the Son, uncreated, self-existing, over all, and blessed forever. And then lastly comes the proclamation in verse 14. This glorious one who is unmistakably God is also man. When God created Adam and placed him in the garden, he said, let them have dominion. And when Adam fell, that dominion fell into the hands of Satan. And the Lord Jesus came as a man to reclaim man's lost estates and to wrest them back from the evil one. And redemption is incomplete without a millennial reign on the earth when Jesus, as man, will sit on the throne of the world and reign.
And so runs the internal counsel of God. The world has little use for Jesus. People in some areas pay him lip service, but even they use the term God rather than the name of Jesus Christ, lest someone be offended. It never seems to occur to anyone that they are offending both him and the God whom they invoke. But the day is coming when every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is Lord. Daniel saw that day coming, and he saw that day being celebrated in heaven. Thank you for being patient this morning. We got through the first 14 verses. Guess what? We got 14 more to go in this chapter. But I promise, because what we did today, the next 14 will go pretty quick. Because you'll say, yeah, I know about that. I've heard about that. I know where that comes from. And I know where we're going. And that's what everybody wants to know. Where did I come from? And where am I going? And you got to know those. You got to know those. Where did you come from? You came from the Creator. See, most of you would have thought, well, I came from my parents. Yeah, your parents were the vehicle that the Creator used to get you here. Let me say that again. You as parents, we as parents, are the very vehicles that God uses to get his creation to earth. Now, with that being said, what's your position as a parent? Only a manager for such a short time. And if you get that right, you'll get a lot right. And if a lot of parents would get that right, we'd do a lot better. Because we are all created in the image of who? Of God and his image. And he loves us. And he's made us to glorify him. So now you know where you come from. Now you know what your purpose is to glorify God. The question is, how are you going to respond? Because how you respond dictates where you go. I can respond and say, well, I don't believe that. And I can do my own thing, and I will spend an eternity in hell without Christ. Or I can say, hey, you know what? That makes total sense. He created me to give him glory, and because of that, I give my life to him and allow him to do whatever he wants with what he's created. And once you do that, and you give your life to him, it's done. You don't have to worry about that question ever again. Because why? It's been settled. The Ancient of Days have settled it. And if you got any issue, you have to go talk to my daddy. And I can't do that, or I'll do that, but I'm only going to do what the Lord wants me to do. Because why? Because now I live in the kingdom of God. I have the kingdom of God living inside of me. And so I live for him. Daniel, in the situation that brought him to where he was, he believed in God Jehovah. And he put his life and gave his life that God could do anything he wanted to. And he was a man that was found faithful. And God never left him. And Daniel could say, oh, I was 15, I was 16 years old, and I was taken away from home.
But God took me, and God saved my life, and He's never left me, and I'm still with Him. I don't know what your background is, friend. But I would guess that Daniel, he could identify with whatever background you have. And he today would tell you, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, trust Him, and you will never, ever be disappointed.